I guess, like, maybe start by talking a little bit about your initial trips. To the Patents and what sort of inspired you to go there.
What inspired me to go there was just knowing I could go, and it was actually making the watercolors. So I had started those from, like, in 2000, when JPEGs online got that big. And I pulled them offline and would make these watercolors from these totally pixelated images. And I thought, well, it might be interesting to go to the Patent and get a different set of reference images. Or actually to just go and see. And then the photographer I was working for said, take a camera and rent a telephoto lens. And he helped me rent a really good telephoto lens. And I went, and what ended up happening was a series of photographs that weren't really very good reference images, but they were really interesting photographs. And that just got me delving deeper into it. And it gave me a different understanding of the pageant. It gave me a little better understanding of it. You know, I'm still an outsider, but I sort of hung out with the insiders in a way, and that sort of changes the perspective a little bit. So I was, it increased a little bit of empathy. So it was less just these weird pictures online, this weird thing, but this actual whole subculture that existed and in ways related back to me as someone who, you know, I mean, I watched Miss America pageant in the 60s when I was a little kid. I'm sure I didn't watch it without any criticality, because I know my mother would have been very critical of it. It was just not even so much as a feminist, just as someone who would find that kind of display something to be critical of. Anyway, so it just helped me get more and more into it, and I kept working in the studio. So the images that are not photographs, are not directly come from photographs, I never worked with any of the pictures I took. These are all like the bathing suits, and then I did a series of oil paintings as well, are all from official online, official pictures that I pull offline. And then everything that's a photograph are images that, and the video are images that I took at the pageants. I felt like, and interrupt me and ask a question anytime you want,
yeah,
and stop me from going off on a tangent. I felt that if I were to take the image, there's a way in which there's an anonymity, like there's in both of them, whether or not in both the photographs and the paintings, there's a sense of, I feel anyway, that there's a sense of them as types, as not as a specific, that clearly is a specific person. And I felt like the same was true in the photographs to a great extent, less so in the video because you see more of them and they open up a little bit, but there's still a repetition of type and type. But I think the reason I never used my own photographs as reference images is I felt like there would be a breaking of that barrier. And that didn't interest me. That wasn't what I was doing before. It's more an exploration of what this subculture says about our overall culture. And to take it down to a personality takes you off in a different direction and stops and gives you a way out of looking at it as, you know, this is a type, and what does it say about who we are as overall types?
Yeah. Well, it reminds me too, the first work I was acquainted with you was when we first met, which you were working for Larry Clark, and I ended up coming to stay there and working for him as well. And you were, I remember hanging on the wall in Larry's studio was a newspaper clipping from the Times, I believe, that was a story about the Good Girls Project, which was, I was very, yeah, it was I remember looking at it, and I didn't know anything about anything then, and I was kind of, I was very impressed. It was kind of interesting, like someone's in the Times. But you had been involved in the Good Girls Poster Project, which, in a sense, like these almost, you know, these, you know, the pageants are almost episodic. They change with each passing year. There's a sort of revolving door of faces and types, and they fit similar models from year to year. And the Good Girl Project, you know, you were drawing very, very simple black and white ink drawings of men and women, mostly women, right, that were almost kind of caricature cartoon figures in a way that had each one a word underneath the bottom. So right. You might have an affirmative word, such as princess, always with a bit of irony, or a word such as slut, or, you know, so they were about projection, and they were about kind of types that we would, as viewers, project onto, and what it meant to sort of occupy that space of receiving those projections. And one thing that they posited was the good girl and then the bad girl. So there was always this kind of, this dichotomy and this question of, you know, which side of the fence would you be perceived as being on? And it feels to me that there's a very important part about the pageantry culture as well that has that kind of dichotomy in the background too.
Yeah. I also think it's also about, and it's true in the pageant as well, that it's that you're on both sides. You know, so one thing I really like to do when I put the posters up was I would put Cotton Heaty next to each other, and they'd be looking at each other, and they were essentially the same drawing, you know, slight variations, but they looked pretty much the same. And it was that there was no, you know, I mean, one minute you're Cutie and the next minute you're Conch. You know, it's sort of like, you know, that's how people talk to you, that's how you talk to yourself. That's the way the stereotypes work. I think the same can be said in a slightly more subtle way with the pageant, that, you know, it's a subculture, and most of us are outside that subculture. But the way in which subcultures always speak of the broader culture they're a part of, and I feel can tell us things about it. And for me in particular, it's this idea of who's the woman. I mean, the Good Girls were about who is a woman in the society, and how does our language reflect the way we actually think about ourselves and each other. And so this is the pageant brings that up in a quieter way with the idea that it's, you know, with the Good Girl Project, the coding, the sort of cultural type was there. It was in your face. The idea of the posters were they were in your face. They were on the street. I would put up, like, I might go out one night and put up, like, 200 posters.
How long did they last?
You know, I put them up from 92 to 94. I did a few in 95 for, like, specific things. And people were telling me they were still seeing them in like the 2010s.
Okay.
Wow. You know, it's been like maybe only a few years since somebody has it, like on the side of a, what are those trash cans called, those big
dumpsters,
yeah. You know, in a neighborhood that I never put them up in. But some of them would be gone the next day. But the more I put the, I mean, I got, the only thing that happened towards the end that really, really felt good was the guys who go out and get paid to do it. So I did a big thing, you know, because you could do this then, you know, this is the mid-90s. So on the side of a construction site, I did like a big thing on a wood wall. And I came, walked by that wall when I was done, and the paid guys had gone around it. They hadn't gone over it. And I, yeah, so that made me feel like, okay, I've got credits doing this, but I'm okay. People respect it, they get what I'm doing. But I think, you know, we're all so, you know, that project started partly because I was angry of the dialogue inside of feminism for ignoring how much we all carry this baggage, the assumption that if you're a good feminist, you're over this baggage, you don't have it, and we don't have to address it. And I got very frustrated with some of the organizations I was involved with in the early 90s because I saw that way of thinking stopping certain dialogues from happening and stopping certain problems from being really delved into. And I heard that kind of language coming from people talking inside of it, you know, like, you know, ideas of, you know, being good, you know. There was a certain pressure, like the good girl inside of that. And so I felt like, you know, but in a way we all sort of also all know that. So when you show it, it's like, oh yeah, thanks for reminding me. And I think with this, it becomes quieter. It becomes, not quieter, but not as obvious.
What I see it doing too is that it's a kind of competition. So it suggests something about how we live in a culture where we're constantly auditioning for something, auditioning for validation, or, you know, in a sense there's a competing with one another, while at the same time you watch a video such as this and you understand that those contestants, in a sense, they're like living for that moment. They're very collectively, they're accomplishing something. They're showing off that they've been that they have a discipline, that they've kind of arrived to do what they're there to do, and they've kind of shown up. And then the opposite of another facet of that is, I think, the way that the pageantry it can be a presentation of this kind of idealism, you know, or this at least an ideal itself in a way. To me, I read it as potentially being very repressive in a way. So there's some way that you're playing with the cracks that come out and show the sort of, you know, the sort of chinks in that armor, in a sense.
Yes. I'm not going to just read through it all. I think that's all really true. It's not something I've thought about a whole lot until we were talking about it, and I think it's really interesting, and it is very much a part of what this is, and I think it's the appeal of it. And there was a slightly different twist on that has really stuck with me is. There was a while in the around the beginning of the Iraq War where I was working with painting images of war casualties, just because I felt like nobody was dealing with this imagery. And I quit doing it because it just felt like I was aestheticizing war and it was uncomfortable, but I ended up with this body of images and I made, I got a lot of, again, really pixelated little JPEGs of suicide bombers after the dump bombing. So the remains. And I played with them and I made wallpaper like that out of them and did things. And then I was putting them with the pageant stuff in some installation pieces I was doing, and I realized, and I hope this doesn't seem like a big stretch, because it really speaks to sort of part of what this whole thing is that there's a way in which the people who compete in these pageants, the people who do that, there's a way in which you're looking for meaning inside the crowd. You're looking for a way to be that which is really important, to excel. It's where you're going to get all the kudos and all the gifts. So if you're in a, you know, what's the most important thing you can do as a human being in a certain fundamentalist Islamic subculture? You blow yourself up for the cause. And then you and your family and everybody get all the rewards. You get it in heaven, everybody else. And I know this is a stretch. But I think that it speaks about some way of the alienation of being in the world and how we need to shine, which is why I'm saying it's not at all separate from that, because then you have this competition with the goal of winning, and at each level you win, you get more prizes, and you stand out more, and if you get to the top, you become that special thing. So you still get to live, but, you know, you're still like this. So there are all kinds of, like, ways in which, and we've also talked about the alienation of that comes with being spectator, absorbing yourself into the pageant without using the pageant as a way to be sort of alienated from yourself. But
I mean, maybe that's one of the contradictions of that exceptionalism, and then also the kind of anonymity of this crowd that you've created, or the crowd that the pageant presents.
I could say that in the repetition, and part of the point of the repetition for me is there really is no way to be that sort of exceptional, special. It's a constant sort of variation on the same, and, you know, a new crop every year. You know, the same is true in the art world. You know, there's like the artist of the year, the artist of the moment. And, you know, I've been around long enough now, I've seen a lot of them come and go. You know, who remembers who Miss America was in 1972? I mean, you might if she got really famous, but most of them didn't. Most of them didn't even do, you know, a lot of them just got married and had kids. I worked as school teachers. I've looked them all up. I know their history. To me, the way in which we try and make everything so special, and it's really just this constant, the repetition of life, the constant repetition.
So do you see in a sense the pageantry as a kind of allegory for the art world?
I see it as an allegory for the art world in the way that it can be an allegory for a lot of different things. I mean, the art world is another subculture. And I think they both reflect on each other in the same way as they reflect out into the broader world. They each tell us something about the bigger culture at large. And, you know, the art world tells us a lot about the role of money in our culture and the meaning of money. And in a different way, it tells us about the meaning of conformity and the way in which conformity and I mean, you could take a lot of the same arguments I'm making here and find different aspects of the culture brought out inside of the art world. But the emphasis would be on different places. I hear it's much more on a direct relationship to sexuality, to the feminine, to the role of what a woman is and how a woman is normalized and sexualized in the culture, in what ways, like what we value. In the art world, I think you would get a lot more into how we value money, how we value commodity, how we normalize dissidents. Because you're not going to find much dissidence in this culture. It's going to creep in. It's going to be how it deals with that and brings it out. So I think, in that sense, yes, but I also think it's like, it's interesting how different aspects, if you take a group, the culture, what it can tell you, and the ways of looking at it can tell you a lot about what the culture is.
Also, I mean, there's a way we talked about it a bit as we were selecting some of the photographs as well. The different photographs in here relate to different almost positions present that you photographed. So, for instance, here you have like the spectator of the competition. In the image over there, you have the judges and the contestant. Here you have almost a very highly mediated thing that almost suggests something about the aftermath of the contestant. And we were talking about how many of the many like news hosts, television hosts, actually female television hosts found their start in sort of pageant models. So thinking about the pageant as a kind of system and this idea that systems produce operations that further produce the system. So you get this kind of cycle of a belief structure really that's embedded in the situation.
Yeah, I think we were, we also sort of talked a lot about how it maps out in that way, the different parts of the pageant and how they represent different things and how they are represented in the work. So the judges as sort of the gatekeepers, the arbitrators, and also the audience is the voyeur. Then the gallery viewer becomes that. I'm not quite getting it right. We did a lot better before when we were talking about it. But there was the vulnerability and the sexualization in the bathing suit, the trophy in the gown, and the different ways in which those stand and work with each other and talk about. How the whole pageant functions, and how we bring it back in here to the world.
And can I ask you how do you identify with the contestant, figure the contestant?
My relationship with the contestants is complicated, I think. There's the part of me that is sees them as just a symbol that I have a distance from. And that's the easy part. The other part of me is how I was formed as a teenage girl, and my own insecurities as a woman. So there is my own self-judgment and and sense of not measuring up in that physical way. But the contestants do, my legs are short, I don't have gray hair. I always want. That's why the girls in the posters all have gray hair too. So there's that dynamic to me, and there's also, as I make them, I judge them, and I judge, there's that judging that we all have inside our head that I find really interesting to watch. Myself do, so it's like, you know, I judge her, and then I judge myself in relationship to her, and then I judge who she might be, and who I am in relationship to that. So there's, as I'm making them, there's all of that kind of garbage thought going on. But I think inside of that garbage thought that we all have becomes who is, I mean, that's part of what interests me about all of the stuff I do, is that garbage thought is what we don't pay attention to, and that's how we really form who we are. That's what makes us who we are. So I'm working on this video, and I've thought about these images for forever, and I've thought about these things, and I paid a lot of attention to this kind of way in which our ideas of who we are formed and what happens with that. And I'm sitting there making it, and I'm like hearing myself say, well, of course she didn't win. Look at that. Look at what she's doing in her talent thing. Or, my goodness, she just blew that question. Or look at the outfit she chose for this thing. And it's like, and I'm listening to myself do that and go like, yeah, that's what this whole project is about in a way. It's about how, you know, and it goes back to what you were saying about competition. You know, I think that there's that way that we've taken some of these sort of very natural tendencies we have and morphed them and really hyper, make them really hyper in our culture and really intensified them, and then they get used in a way that manipulates us and makes us, I kind of always hate saying manipulates us, because that assumes that there's somebody on the outside making these decisions, and I feel like we're all participating in these decisions. That was kind of what the posters were about. That's what was important to me, the posters, is that we're all participating in this. I think that that's a little less obvious in this, because we can, it's really easy to, I'm not letting you talk at all. I'm going to shut up for a minute and let you talk. I think what's important to one thing that is both dangerous and interesting to me is that we cannot look at some of these issues in these, because we can just say it's this pageant stuff. Isn't this sort of weird subculture?
I see a difference in. I mean, I think there's something really interesting that happens between the photographs and the watercolors. The watercolors function; they have an element of caricature. There's a kind of almost like you can imagine sort of behind the scenes reactions that people are having to one another and dealing with all of that internal thought process and conflict. And it's in a sense, there's an ambivalence that comes through in the paintings and the watercolor that's different than in the photographic representation. You know, you're maybe your own ambivalence is in there more, or your own the contradictions of how you identify and disidentify with the figure at the same time.
The paintings.
Yeah.
I think. Yeah, I think it's part of its the nature of the medium, and part of its the nature of where I'm placed for the medium.
And I also.
I mean, you know that too, because you've worked with photography and with montage, and you're in a different place when you're working with each medium.
But it's also a question of how you make yourself complicit through the possibility of having a mean-spiritedness, even if it's toward yourself and turn back at yourself in a way within the watercolors. There's a kind of there's a way in which it allows the ridiculousness of this to have to find an expression. You can say something about that. Or maybe it's where I see judgment showing up.
Yeah, I'd say a lot of judgment. And also I think there's a judgment. I like to think that there's an empathy too, because there's a way in which I know sort of I also have an understanding. I like to think, at least, that I have an understanding of what's made these women be there. Why are you, like, understanding what? And one thing that's really interesting in working with this is understanding what the pageant culture is and what it does for some of these women. For some of these women, it's the only expression they ever had to really push out into the world and to really find identity, because they came from very, you know, restricted, small town backgrounds, a lot of them. And so that there's this, like, when I work with them, it's like, yeah, I'm horrified by it. There's a part of me that's horrified by it, and horrified by what it does, and how it looks at it, and how these women are seeing themselves. There's another part of it that empathizes with them and understands that, and then there's another part that's and then there's another part that empathizes with them and sort of sees. I just totally lost my train of thought. I'm gonna go back to it.
Well, I mean, maybe it would help, like, thinking about like this idea of the function of anthropology being not to study the other, but to learn something about ourselves through the encounter with the other. So, you know, I keep thinking, like, what is the pageant as a representation of the other?
To me.
Yeah, or even as a viewer coming to the show, you know. In a sense, we're in New York, we live in New York, we're sophisticated in a way that, you know, and this comes back to another question, which maybe even is brought up a little bit by this sort of waving beauty queen, and who's very meek, contrasts with that, and almost has a kind of fascist gesture in a way, you know, and I can't, it doesn't escape me that Trump is involved in hosting, sponsoring beauty pageants as well, you know, so there's this idea of that kind of split between us and them that may also be represented subtly in the show.
I think we can't, in this audience, not feel the us and them. Because this is the art world, which is its own subculture with its own set of rules, and this is the pageant world, which is a different subculture with its own set of rules, and each looks a little ridiculous to the other. You know, there are probably very few people in the pageant world who would feel comfortable in the art world, and there are very few people in the art world who would feel comfortable being involved in the pageant world on any kind of serious level. And we would both seem ridiculous. I think what you were saying, as I realized something you've been trying to get at when we've talked about this, is how there's a ridiculousness that's almost, I'm bringing back on to myself. And in seeing myself, by seeing myself in another. And I think that's true. I think that there's sort of a self. There is contained in all my work a certain anger back at myself. A certain level of working out my own self-hatred, in a way. Like working out my own relationship to who I am and my own value of my own sense of what I am in the world. So, I mean, self-hatred might be too strong. That might have been more true in my early 20s. But then I was less capable of directly addressing it because it was just too frightening. I think that's true of a lot of young artists who try to work with it, is that it becomes very simplistic because it's too frightening to go into a really deep.
It makes me think of how we look for validation from, you know, in things outside of ourselves, and even like, I don't know, a minute ago I had the thought about, you know, oftentimes parents don't understand their children wanting to go into the arts field because it feels is so precarious or something. It feels almost like useless, and that sort of art may not have like a viable function inside of this culture, vice versa. You know, we'll never understand what, or maybe it'll always look ridiculous, the sort of talent show aspect, you know, the twirling baton, playing the piano.
How does that relate back to the alcohol?
It's just like a division.
Right.
A division between what two worlds can and can't validate of each other.
Right, right. Personal level, I find that really hard to deal with. What do I see? I think I'd like to switch the subject a little bit and talk about montage.
Yeah.
And the show is a montage. And the way we both work with montage.
Sounds good.
Because we're going over some of the same territory a little bit.
Okay.
So I want you to talk about the show as montage.
I guess part of if you think about the entire show as a montage, one of the feelings I got is the different positions presented in the show, from the spectator to the participant to the past participant to the judge to the master of ceremony to the crooner who's almost like the court eunuch in some way. It's like there are these different positions that we all occupy socially in relation to those around us. So thinking about what it is to have all of those to simultaneously like play all of those different roles and how incompatible they can feel with one another. So montage opens up this kind of fractured space in a way.
Mm-hmm.
But also maybe it's just more that
and you don't see it as the way in which they relate to each other inside that fracture?
No, it's absolutely, it's all about the way they relate to each other inside that fracture.
Okay. Yeah.
But maybe I'm thinking about sort of internal splits or something.
Right. Because I think about, like, you use montage a lot in your recent work. And there's a way in which you're looking at these different parts and putting them together and looking at sort of taking apart what the overall project into pieces and then emphasizing certain pieces through your montages. And
like, those different positions become like a lens to look at the whole thing from.
Right,
But it's also, it's funny because oftentimes in the studio, going over to your studio, you have even more of a montage, And I feel like in a sense, the show is kind of a cleaned up version of that in a way. And the magazines maybe, as far as things that are present here, are the most montage, I think, in a way. They're the kind of messiest places where all of these different, all the different positions come together.
When it was making the book on the Good Girl Project, that was the first thing that sort of showed me how to bring that sort of montage outside the studio. And it was the pleasure, the fun of making that book that led me to the magazines. And then the fun of making the magazines got you to help with one, and the last one, sending images for the last one, and that was like totally rad and crazy. So everybody should check it out. It's the last issue there.
And the content's strange in relationship to the show, too. I mean, it's an interesting, it's an interesting contrast in some ways.
Yeah. Yeah, because, I mean, the closest you get are these, where there's the wallpaper behind them. And part of what he's referring to in the studio is sort of the leftovers of tracings and wallpaper and, you know, a few abandoned drawings and torn off remains from installation projects I've done. And but I think, you know, for me, part of the excitement of working with that way, and even in putting up this show, and some of what I see with how you work with it, is that when you start putting these things together, not like pulling out just particular parts, but like pulling things apart and putting them back together again, or bringing in disparate images to emphasize particular line of thought, you get new meanings, like new things become apparent. Like you get these relationships that don't make sense, and then they make sense, and then they tell you something that you didn't really know. Sometimes it's just specifically about the work, sometimes it's more about the overall conceptual conceit you're working with, or the political conceit. And I find that really exciting, and part of what really keeps me working in that way. Like I did a big installation piece when I was at a residency in Florida that was all about the pictures of young male stars that I found in Us magazine. It was like the poster issue for the young male stars. And, you know, we both work for Larry, so we've seen this imagery a lot. And I took that project to be an answer to Larry. That was my starting point, an answer to Larry's relationship to those imageries. But in montaging it and playing with it, a whole other story came out. And that, you know, if I had just been working image, and not montaging and playing with it, and building a whole environment out of it, I wouldn't have gotten that. I wouldn't have gotten at that story as much, which was essentially the story of the death of my brother. And how that reverberated, even though he never lived to be that age. And just sort of that whole, like, playing with it. When we were talking first about putting the show together, and you were really digging into that aspect of this work with me, I felt that opened up a whole, like, a bigger level of thinking about that way of taking things apart, putting them together, and like layering them in different ways.
It's interesting, like that issue about excess or something, you know, like what we don't want to speak to, what's like emotionally problematic, where it comes out in the artwork. It's funny because I look, like I see it here, I think that's one of the things I mean to speak to when I see there being a kind of, you know, ambivalence or a kind just, you know, if you take the kind of cartoon subjectivity of pageant contestant, these start to break that down. They start to show a sort of excess that is like seeping out from behind it. And then thinking like, you know, I guess thinking about what the pageants are as almost like a kind of, you know, they're kind of almost like a marriage ritual. Of giving away and coming of age, and then this idea about montage, it seems like it ruptures something, you know, it's like about the kind of cracks that are created and the excess that comes out when you put two things together. Mm-hmm. And it just reminded me of like a little bit of like other kind of cultural rituals that are present or timely right now, like even thinking about, you know, like a male version of pageants, like the NFL games and like how that ends up bringing out, like, you know, it almost like puts pressure on the system to expose what's actually going on. The fact that the sports channel or the NFL games actually function as a kind of advertising outlet for the military or whatever it is.
And
know.
It's white owners and black players,
yeah.
And white fans for the most part.
Yeah,
accepting
and social problems that are present. So there's a, I guess that's kind of what I was like meaning in terms of pointing to the pageants as having this kind of repressive facade that they're presenting. And I'm just like, you know, it's interesting. You know, you mentioned something so personal, the death of your brother, and you know, I know how important a certain moment in your life that is, just in terms of how your family dealt with the situation. It strikes me as like really, I don't know, that issue of like upholding facades and the breakdown of it seems really pertinent inside the show, you know, on a very personal level, in a way. And even though it's kept in, it's like presented in terms of this subcultural social project that may not be related to you, it also feels very related.
You mean this particular project?
Yeah.
Oh, I mean, yeah. You know, and there's also the one thing I haven't talked about, and I'm trying not to talk about, but I know. And then can we go to questions after this?
Yeah.
So one thing that I think gives me a particular perspective on this subject, draws me to the subject, and it's also why I'm drawn to the subject, are two really important things in my life. One, I grew up in a very female family. I'm the middle of three sisters. And my father was very retired. He was a professor, hung out in the study. He didn't have a lot to do with the family. I mean, he wasn't not there, but he wasn't a father figure. So it was a very feminine household. And then the other thing, is in junior high school, I became a class slut, and I was ostracized for 2 years. And then I just dropped out of school. So, and that gave me a really interesting take on, you know, how sexuality can be manipulated and used against someone, but also how women look at each other. Those two things, really clearly. Competition between women, because my sisters and I could use each other like mad. And then also the way in which, when I was a class slut, it was the men that were directing the aggressiveness to me, but the perpetuation of it was all done by the women, by my female students. And it was the females who put me in my friend. So there was this sort of, it gave me it gave me a different way. I feel like one thing that to really look at a subject like with a twist, like to get at the backside of a subject with a twist, you need a perspective that puts you in a little bit of a different place so that you can dig at it in a way that other people aren't quite looking at it because they don't see that, because it's so much of their norm. And so I feel like that perspective has given me, is what allowed me to sort of dig into the Good Girl Project and to this. And it's also probably part of the anger that you see and the working out of some of that anger. But it's also like just an understanding of what these sort of cultural things mean and how at their worst they can be acted out. On a very small scale, because it's easy to see them acted out badly, like via Harvey Weinstein on a big scale. And then you can dismiss it, but if you see it on a small scale and you look at, so you see it on a small scale and you look at how it's constantly perpetuated inside of our culture. So you look at like the, so you go in and you look at the norms that are perpetuating and setting up those situations. So I think that goes back to the other and how we relate today and some other things. And I don't know why I'm not on that. But anyway.
That's interesting. Should we have any questions?
Yeah. Sure.
So, because our culture doesn't really have shared values to any great degree that would generate actual rituals, the way earlier cultures spectacle and the ritual was to celebrate a particular thing that was an agreed upon ethos. So at the core of all of this, it is empty. It is superficial because we don't have that.
Because we use spectacles like this in the NFL game to fill that in.
But it doesn't fill it. So we feel there's like a large degree of sadness in it because it's empty.
I would not argue with you on that.
And that's what is brilliant about how you capture it. And me being a video artist, I can really feel your choices this video, and I imagine that you may have captured images from TV access, local access channels on this.
No,
you actually went there?
That's all mine, yeah. Oh, you know what? All of these are, I went to two Miss America pageants and a Miss New York State and Miss New Jersey pageant, yeah.
So the images were shot from
my camera.
The audience?
Yeah. All of these are from an audience perspective.
I find it really engaging and effective, the quality of the image.
Yeah. Well, you wouldn't, if I'd shot them from a television,
uh-huh.
It would have been mediated.
Yeah.
It would have been mediated and
I
seen.
I just thought it was like one of those off channels.
No.
Okay.
I'm curious about the choice of materials to work with watercolor. Because I think I've mentioned this to you before, but I've certainly thought about it being in this space. There's something so, I feel like, innocent about that medium. That's what you teach young children. And it's, I mean, I know a lot of artists use it as well. But I think there's something very kind of interesting in that choice to use watercolor and the palette that you use. It's like this. There's a quiet, menacing quality to the works being watercolor as opposed to oil or another medium, and I wonder if you would talk about that at all, or if that was part of your thought process.
Yes and no. They started, I got to these watercolors, I mean, it just sort of was a flow of thought. It wasn't like, I'm now gonna work with Miss America pageant, and I will sometimes pick a medium that's really difficult to sort of make other things happen, like something I can't control. So I was making inks on print paper, so they would just like, and I would lose control of them. And that's sort of where these started. And then they just evolved as I got more and more engrossed in the subject itself. Then that loss of control, it wasn't the medium as much as, the relationship between me and and it evolved into watercolors. And the watercolors evolved into oils. I'm not, because I wanted to make these little, I wanted to make them postcard size. So all of the first, most of the oil paintings are 5x7. I did towards the end get a little bit bigger because I just, the idea of there being postcards had kind of disappeared as the project grew, and they didn't need to be 5x7 anymore, they didn't need to be little postcards. But, yeah.
I had a question. I guess just, sitting here and then also seeing the show over the last few weeks, I feel, and maybe I even mentioned this when we were doing the installation, but there's such a sense of distancing that I get when I look at the work. Like, there's always, it's either like the distance of that being a watercolor and there's no, it's not like an actual you know, photograph of a woman, or this woman right here where we see her on a TV screen and then we see her but she's so far away, and then she's also projected really large. So there's, for me, there's like a lot of distancing that's happening in the work and also masking. You know, like if you, there is like, you know, this collage, we might see the woman, like her actual face, this lower piece, but then the face is flipped, you know, and mm-hmm. she's upside down. And I was wondering, you know, as you were making this work, like, you're clearly very involved, and you've been to a lot of pageants, you've been dealing with this subject for a long time. And did that thought ever come up to you as you were making the work? And, you know, when you were talking just at the very end about place, you know, like your place in making this, like, there's this physicality of being distanced, and then maybe there's like some mental need to have distance from the work as well. And, you know, for me, like, there's all this sense of distancing. We don't see the woman's face, we see her feet, but then I always get really sort of almost creeped out when I watch the video, because it's, some of that distancing is taken away, you know, and like the girl hitting the ball into this, like, it was that, that I see that every day, like when I come in, I just see her hitting the beach ball into the crowd, and she seems so plastic, and, you know, I don't know, so I've been thinking about that, and what do you, what are your thoughts?
I haven't thought about that a lot. I think some of it's just inherent in the subject, like, there's going to be a distance between me. There's a, I mean, it's inherent in sort of my conceptual approach to the subject. Mm-hmm. I think some of it is also how close you are to it. Like, there's less of a distancing in a face that has more detail. But I also think there is a way in which I do a distance from, like, I even think that there's a certain distancing in the video as well. There's mm-hmm. the, you know, the collaging, the shaky shots. There's never that much time spent with anyone, and there are certain places where I move the sound just a tiny bit off, mm-hmm. so it's not quite right. and I think, yeah, I do have, yeah, there is a distancing, and I haven't really thought about what it means to me now. I think part of it is that that's true in all my work, because there's a, it's not, you know, I'm not going in there with my emotions, digging into the paint. I mean, I am sometimes, but it's all with, there's all a conceptual thing, but there's, I'm also putting concept inside of it, so it's not just an emotional response to something, mm-hmm. it's also a conceptual response, mm-hmm. and then that puts a layering in that gives a distance. Mm-hmm.
To me, it feels almost like it's inherent in the subject matter too, almost mm-hmm. like the way you could think of the contestants, similar to like a catalog model where too much personality is the wrong thing that can no longer be a site to project onto. Mm-hmm. Want it to be mm-hmm. generic and to have that kind of remove.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Any more questions? Look at the magazines in the back, and there's also, if you didn't have a chance to see, there's a book that I made that grew out of my Good Girl Project. Mm-hmm. Oh. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Close personal friends.
Hi.
Mr.
So
Little Mr. New York and Little Miss New York. From Rochester. And Brent Wood from Casterland, which is in Lewis County, right here in northern New York. Smile pretty for the cameras.